10 mind-blowing facts you didn't know about the moon. If you're an astronomy fan, you've probably heard that the moon has no atmosphere. But did you know that it actually has an invisible layer surrounding it? That layer is the lunar exosphere, and it's responsible for the moon having something you wouldn't even imagine. A tail. Yes, you heard right. The moon has a tail like a comet's. But why have we never seen it before? In this video, we'll explore that and more. Let's get started. The moon has an extremely tenuous atmosphere called the moon exosphere. Although we often say that the moon has no atmosphere, that statement is not entirely correct. In reality, the moon possesses a fragile atmosphere known as the lunar exosphere. Unlike Earth's atmosphere, which is dense and rich in gases such as nitrogen and oxygen, the lunar exosphere is composed of a tiny number of scattered atoms and molecules. It's so faint that its particles rarely collide with each other, which radically differentiates it from a conventional atmosphere. This exosphere is primarily composed of helium, neon, hydrogen, sodium, and potassium atoms, which originate from several sources: the interaction of the solar wind with the lunar surface, the bombardment of micrometeorites, and the release of gases from the moon's interior. Its surface pressure is about 10^-14 times that of Earth, making it virtually a vacuum by human standards. NASA's LADEE, Lunar Atmosphere and Dust Environment Explorer mission, launched in 2013, played a key role in studying this layer. Thanks to it, it was confirmed that the lunar exosphere varies with the solar cycle and meteoritic activity. Although not an atmosphere in the classical sense, this exosphere plays an essential role in understanding the moon's space environment and how it interacts with the solar wind. The moon has a sodium tail like a comet. Although it sounds incredible, the moon has a kind of tail, very similar to that of a comet. This sodium tail is a real and documented phenomenon, composed of sodium atoms that break off from the lunar regolith and are propelled by the pressure of sunlight, extending for hundreds of thousands of kilometers in the opposite direction of the sun. The tail is so faint that it cannot be seen with the naked eye, but sensitive spectroscopic instruments from Earth have detected it. Sodium atoms are released from the lunar surface primarily by three processes: micrometeorite impacts, solar wind bombardment, and ultraviolet light-induced desorption. Once in the exosphere, these atoms are left aimless, but solar radiation acts on them, generating an acceleration that forms this impressive invisible tail. This phenomenon was first discovered in 1998 by researchers at Boston University during a meteor shower. Subsequently, studies using telescopes and numerical simulations have confirmed its existence, showing that the tail can extend to lengths exceeding 400,000 kilometers. Not only is this finding visually striking from an astrophysical perspective, but it also reminds us that even celestial bodies as seemingly quiet as the moon are immersed in complex and dynamic processes. The lunar surface contains traces of gold, platinum, and other precious metals. One of the lesser known but scientifically confirmed aspects of the moon is that its surface harbors traces of precious metals such as gold, platinum, palladium, iridium, and rhodium. These elements are not found in large quantities, but their mere presence has piqued the interest of scientists and private companies alike, especially in the context of future space mining. The origin of these metals is linked to the impacts of metallic meteorites throughout lunar geological history. With no atmosphere to slow them down, many meteorites rich in heavy metals have collided directly with the surface, leaving deposits of materials that on Earth are concentrated in the mantle or deep veins. Unlike our planet, the moon lacks significant geological activity, meaning that these metals have not sunk inward but remain accessible near the surface. Samples brought back by the Apollo missions and remote analysis by spectroscopy have confirmed the presence of these elements. Although their concentration is low, sometimes as little as a few parts per billion, the idea of exploiting them becomes more viable if combined with other lunar activities, such as the extraction of water or helium-3. Beyond their economic value, these discoveries also help us reconstruct the history of impacts on the solar system and gain a better understanding of the original composition of the materials that formed it. The Apollo missions left retroreflectors that still work. One of the most enduring legacies of the Apollo missions is not in museums, but still on the surface of the moon, working with absolute precision, laser retroreflectors. These devices, installed by the Apollo 11, 14, and 15 missions, were designed to reflect beams of laser light sent from Earth, thus allowing an exact measurement of the distance between the two bodies. A retroreflector is a set of cube-shaped prisms that reflect any incoming beams of light directly back in the direction of origin, no matter the angle of entry. Thanks to this property, scientists can send laser pulses from ground station to these reflectors and time how long it takes for the beam to return. The distance to the moon is calculated with an accuracy of centimeters, an impressive feat considering the more than 384,000 kilometers that separates us. These retroreflectors have enabled the confirmation that the moon is receding from the Earth by approximately 3.8 centimeters per year, thereby validating Einstein's general theory of relativity and allowing for a detailed study of the Earth-Moon system's orbital motion. More than 50 years after their installation, these devices remain active and are still in use by observatories and universities worldwide. They are tangible proof of how a simple, well-executed experiment can provide decades of valuable knowledge about our natural satellite and the physics of the universe. Hello! Before continuing, like this video if you're enjoying it. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel by activating the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. Solar radiation could subtly affect the rotation of the moon through the YORP effect. The YORP effect, an acronym for Yarkovsky-O'Keefe-Radziejewski-Paddock, is a physical phenomena in which solar radiation gradually alters the rotational motion of a small body in space. Although it is usually applied to the study of asteroids and objects a few kilometers in diameter, some scientists have wondered if this effect could also act, albeit almost imperceptibly, on larger objects such as the moon. The basis of the YORP effect is simple yet powerful. When sunlight hits an object, some of it is reflected, some is absorbed, and then re-emitted as heat. This re-emission is not uniform if the small object has an irregular shape or asymmetric thermal properties, which generates a small recoil impulse that, over time, can change the rotation speed or the orientation of the body's axis. In small asteroids, this effect has been directly observed and is responsible for rotational accelerations measurable on decades-long scales. In the case of the Moon, whose mass and symmetry are much greater, any influence of the YORP effect would be extraordinarily low, perhaps on scales of millions or billions of years. Although there is no direct evidence that the YORP effect is altering the lunar rotation in any significant way, theoretical models that include it help to understand how even sunlight can act as a dynamic force on solar system objects. It also serves as a reminder that space is not static, and that even tiny forces can accumulate noticeable effects over time. The moon has mountains higher than Everest. When we think of towering mountains, it's natural to think of Mount Everest, the highest point on Earth, at 8,848 meters above sea level. However, on the moon, some formations exceed it in relative height, although their geological and reference conditions are very different. One of the most prominent examples is Mons Huygens, considered the highest mountain on the moon, and Mount Leibniz, located near the lunar south pole, which could reach heights of up to 10,700 meters from its base. These mountains were not formed like terrestrial mountain ranges from the movement of tectonic plates, since the moon lacks active tectonics. Instead, many of these elevations arose from massive meteorite impacts in the past or are part of the raised edges of giant impact basins, such as the Mare Imbrium or the South Pole Aitken Basin. Others were formed by primitive volcanic processes when the moon was still inactive. Unlike on Earth, where erosion caused by wind, water, and glaciers slowly wears away mountains, there is no atmosphere or climate on the moon. This allows the elevations to remain intact for billions of years, preserving their original shape with striking sharpness. These mountains represent not only a geological fascination, but also a future challenge for manned lunar exploration. Climbing a lunar mountain would involve facing steep slopes, low gravity, and a total absence of atmosphere. But it would also be an opportunity to get spectacular views of the lunar landscape and of the Earth suspended in the sky. On the Moon, there are also solid tides caused by Earth's gravity. When we talk about tides, we usually think of the Earth's oceans rising and falling under the influence of the Moon. But what few know is that the Earth also generates tides on the Moon. They are not water tides because the Moon lacks visible liquid seas, but solid tides, that is, physical deformations in the lunar crust caused by the Earth's gravitational attraction. This phenomenon occurs because the Earth's gravity exerts a constant force on the Moon. Since both bodies are tidally locked, the Moon always shows the same face to the Earth, the deformation is slightly permanent. Still, it oscillates slightly in relation to the lunar distance during its elliptical orbit. It has been calculated that these variations cause the lunar surface to rise and fall by about 10 to 15 centimeters each orbital cycle. These solid tides were confirmed by instruments placed on the lunar surface during the Apollo missions and by more recent measurements via satellites such as GRAIL. The deformations not only affect the surface but also the lunar interior, contributing to friction and heat processes that could have maintained internal activity for longer than estimated. This phenomenon serves as a reminder that the gravitational interaction between the Earth and the Moon is profound and ongoing. Just as the Moon influences the dynamic behavior of our planet, the Earth also physically and structurally modifies its satellite. In a universe where everything is in motion, even the quietest rock responds to invisible forces that shape it. The Moon has an irregular gravitational field revealed by GRAIL. To the naked eye, the Moon looks like a perfect sphere, but beneath its surface, things are very different. Thanks to NASA's GRAIL, Gravity Recovery and Interior Laboratory mission launched in 2011, scientists discovered that the Moon has a highly irregular gravitational field, with surprising fluctuations that reveal a complex and violent geological history. The GRAIL mission consisted of two twin probes orbiting the forming Moon. By accurately measuring the variations in the distance between them caused by small changes in lunar gravity as they flew over different regions, they were able to create the most detailed gravitational map ever obtained of a celestial body other than Earth. One of the most prominent findings was the identification of mascons, short for mass concentrations, areas buried beneath the surface that have a significantly higher density than the surrounding terrain. These mascons were formed primarily by massive meteorite impacts that created large basins. Subsequently, these depressions were filled with basaltic lava, which is denser than the original material, resulting in a localized increase in gravity. These gravitational anomalies not only help to understand the internal evolution of the Moon, but are crucial for future space missions as they directly affect the orbits of lunar spacecraft and satellites. A poorly calculated trajectory around a mascon zone could destabilize a landing or a prolonged orbit. Thanks to GRAIL, the Moon was no longer seen as a simple inert body. Today, we know that beneath its surface, it holds traces of ancient impacts, magmatic movements, and hidden structures that continue to alter its gravitational field even now, billions of years after its formation. Lunar regolith retains traces for millions of years. One of the most striking aspects of the lunar landscape is its immobility. The footprints left by the Apollo 11 astronauts in 1969 are still there, perfectly marked on the ground as if they had been made yesterday. This is possible thanks to the peculiar nature of lunar regolith, a surface layer of dust and rock fragments that covers the entire Moon. Unlike terrestrial soil, lunar regolith has not been shaped by wind, rain, or biological activity. There is no atmosphere or liquid water on the Moon, therefore there is no erosion in the terrestrial sense. The regolith particles were formed by the constant bombardment of micrometeorites over billions of years. These collisions pulverized rocks, generating a fine, sharp dust with jagged edges that is easily compacted under pressure. When an astronaut steps on this material, the particles do not roll or disperse like sand. Instead, they are held together by electrostatic forces and form a lasting impression. In the absence of wind or rain, that footprint can remain for millions of years, unless another meteorite impacts the exact location. This phenomenon makes the Moon an almost unalterable historical record. Every impact, every human step, every piece of technology left behind becomes a modern fossil sealed in a timeless environment. If any future civilization visits the Moon 10,000 years from now, there's a good chance you'll still be able to see the footprints of Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin as they left them, a silent testimony of our first leap beyond planet Earth. Thanks to the lunar libration, we can see 59% of its surface from Earth. Although it is commonly said that the Moon always shows us the same face, the truth is that from Earth we can observe up to 59% of its total surface, thanks to a phenomenon called lunar libration. This term comes from the Latin libratio, meaning rocking, and describes a small oscillating motion that allows you to see a little beyond the edges of the Moon's visible hemisphere. The libration is the result of a combination of astronomical factors. First, although the Moon is in synchronous rotation with the Earth, i.e. it rotates on its axis in the same time it takes to orbit our planet, its orbit is not perfectly circular but elliptical. This causes its orbital velocity to vary slightly throughout the month, while its rotation remains constant. As a result, sometimes we see a little more of the eastern edge, and at other times, the western edge. In addition, there is a libration in latitude, caused by the slight inclination of the lunar rotation axis concerning its orbital plane. This allows us to see more of the Moon's north pole or south pole alternately. The result of these librations, longitudinal, latitudinal, and parallax, is that over a lunar month we can observe almost an additional 9% of the otherwise hidden lunar surface. Although these movements are subtle and not perceptible to the naked eye during a single night, they can be easily detected by telescopes or lunar photographs taken at different times. The libration is a reminder that even in bodies that appear static, there are fine, predictable movements that expand our window of observation of the cosmos. If these facts surprised you, wait until you hear this. The Moon is moving away from Earth. Yes, just as you heard. We know this thanks to an experiment left behind by Apollo astronauts who left instruments on the Moon years ago. But if the Moon is moving away, why is it doing so? How fast is it moving away? Does this mean we'll one day lose our Moon? Watch the answer to all those questions in this video on the end screens.